The following episode of The Kingdom of Isolation contains footage from the film being discussed. The footage is used solely for the purposes of education, commentary, and criticism under fair use. Please support the animators by watching this film on Disney Plus or home media where available. This episode also contains spoilers throughout.
My fellow Pixar fans, and welcome to the Kingdom of Isolation, where in times of trouble, why not celebrate the magic of Pixar? And today, we're looking at the sequel to the Oscar-winning Finding Nemo, Finding Dory, which came out in 2016. I had fun watching this when it came out, and still do for its beautiful visuals and music from Thomas Newman. May as well get that out of the way early. I think this is a good follow-up, giving us more time with our favourite forgettable friend. This was originally set to come out in November 2015, but was pushed back for reasons I've gone into more detail on in the previous episode covering The Good Dinosaur, which you can find in the top right of your screens if you want to watch that episode to see what the issues were. In short, to summarise though, production issues plagued The Good Dinosaur, which was originally set to come out in 2013 before being pushed back to 2014 and then further into the 2015 release date that it got. That being said, let's go on another adventure with Dory to find her parents. The filmmakers knew early on how important it would be to get the water just right for the film. Whether someone is on the reef, in the open ocean or the aquarium, the water can run more green or more blue, depending on the sequence. Inside the Marine Life Institute, the water actually becomes a light source. Humans tend to fall into silhouettes in the background, and the water really underscores that this is a story about a fish. Before the special premiere in Concord, and this is not the first time I've heard stories regarding something similar to this. We have seen this happen previously. So, yeah. A red band trailer for Sausage Party, which came out the same year, was shown before Finding Dory, causing extreme horror to a PG-rated audience when the trailer was meant for an R-rated audience. This is not the first time we have heard stories like that. And I doubt it will be the last. At the time of Finding Nemo's production, Pixar were not able to animate octopuses since they don't have bone structure. Pearl is a flapjack octopus, as a flapjack octopus was easier to animate at the time. Despite the film featuring jellyfish, which also lacks bone structure. By the time the sequel had come out, all was figured, along with a lot of other things Pixar had been incapable of animating the past decade.
Hi, I'm Dory. I suffer from short-term memory loss.
You deserve it!
That was basically the reaction in my cinema when cute little baby Dory graced our screens for the first time. Her parents, Jenny and Charlie, are voiced by Oscar winner Diane Keaton and four-time Emmy winner Eugene Levy. Diane won her Oscar in 1978 for Annie Hall, as well as a BAFTA for the same role. She's also portrayed Nina Banks in the Father of the Bride movies. Might cover those films at some point later down the road. She was also Kay in another Oscar-winning franchise, The Godfather, Parts 1 and 2 to be specific. Eugene, on the other hand, won two of his Emmys for a comedy show I'm going to have to censor for obvious reasons. Because failure to do so will land me a... His other two Emmys came from SCTV Network in the 1980s. Of course, teenagers of a certain generation will know him best as Jim's dad, Mr. Levenstein, or Levenstein, in the American Pie movies. He's also been in Cheaper by the Dozen 2 and Only Murders in the Building, both starring alongside their Steve Martin, and an episode of the Hercules Disney series. Put it on Disney Plus yesterday, Disney! He's also voiced Lou in Over the Hedge and has also appeared in some not-so-beloved live-action remakes of cartoons and anime like Josie and the Pussycats and Astro Boy.
Hi, Dory!
Ahoy there!
Oh, that laugh is so cute! We get it, Perito! I'm starting to run that joke into the ground. Not gonna stop using it, though. Because why would I not want to use cuteness overload when you have cute little Disney baby kids? They try to play hide-and-seek, only for Dory to almost get pulled by the undertow.
We see the undertow and we say,
let's go.
Oh, good effort, Dory.
What if I forget you? Would you ever forget me?
Don't you just want to give Dory a big hug after that? We then get treated to some more beautiful music from Thomas Newman, back to compose after last being seen composing for Wally. Sometime later, Dory's lost and tries to get help from other fish without success. Although Dory's memory issues were originally based on the theory that fish had short memories, by the time this film was released, that theory was pretty much debunked. However, whether by accident or design, by the late 2010s, the film had become what could be seen as a moving look into what would become known as early onset dementia, or even actual Alzheimer's disease, especially with Dory's struggles with short and long-term memories, and how those close to her cope with her memory issues. My gran had dementia in the latter stages of her life, and this December's going to mark 6 years since she passed. Man, I miss her and my granddad every day. I'm glad they're back together, though. Only they could see me now. The music here is just so heartbreaking and beautiful at the same time.
Hi, I'm Dory. Was it something I said?
There's the Dory voice we all know and love, the always awesome Ellen DeGeneres, who first revealed Finding Dory on her talk show. Hoping a third film doesn't take another 13 years to make. During this montage, we see a VW Beetle, Volkswagen, referencing the time Disney made Herbie Goes Bananas. During the making of that particular film, an actual Volkswagen was dropped into the ocean and never recovered. The name Dory is likely in connection with a Greek mythology sea divinity, Doris, wife of Nereus. As it turns out, that whole montage was building up to the point where Dory first meets Marlin, voiced again by Albert Brooks in the first film. They would have had to have redone the animation for that scene, as the technology might not have been compatible with modern systems. The technology and the character models from 2003 might not have been compatible with modern systems. Fast forward 1 year, and Dory ends up in talking in her sleep and references Wreck-It Ralph in the process.
Give me the ratchet wrench. I can fix it.
There was a deleted scene that ended up being in one of the trailers where she was sleep swimming, which ended up on the cutting room floor for pacing reasons, I assume.
I would say the scariest moment of the trip was the four sharks.
Wait, I thought there were three sharks.
No, there were definitely four.
Wrong, Marlin. There were definitely three. Bruce, Anchor, and Chum. You lose. Next!
Well, you made it. You almost missed the field trip.
Mr. Ray is back and is voiced by Bob Peterson. Marlin tells Dory she can't go because Ray has too many fish to look after. So Dory ends up taking initiative and decides to help Mr. Ray. Nemo is voiced this time by Hayden Rollins, who's also appeared in an episode of Tom and Jerry Go in Animal World. Hayden Rollins replaces Alexander Gold as the voice of Nemo due to Gold having outgrown his original role since Finding Nemo. Bennett DeMann replaced Nicholas Bird as the voice of Squirt for a similar reason.
Where'd you grow up, Dory?
Dory helps Mr. Ray with the field trip for the stingray migration, giving us the first time I ever understood an innuendo.
You see, kids, when two fish love each other...
And we'll stop right there.
Of course, Mr. Ray starts a migration song with his signature, Oh, Rangers! For the Yellers Marble Runs fans out there, I think Mr. Ray is a fan of the old Rangers. Wouldn't you agree? Yellers fans, you can debate that one in the comments. Or maybe, logistically, he should be a fan of the Oceanics. I don't know. Anyway, me, Savage Speeders for life! Ray and Dory warn the kids about the Undertow and the rays are going to develop, which jogs Dory's memory a little. Oh, of course, you're going to get a chorus with some brilliant vocal and harmony work there. We then see the first of Dory's flashbacks of the film, when she gets swept up by the Undertow. The flashbacks were a plot device that were initially going to be included in the first film to show why Marlin was so overprotected of Nemo. The idea didn't pan out in execution, particularly for making Marlin initially hard to like or empathize with. The narrative was instead shifted to show Marlin's tragedy at the very beginning, and the flashbacks were scrapped. Although Stanton revealed he would like to use the framework in a future film. In the scenes flashing back to Dory's childhood, she is a miniature version of her parents. In reality, adolescent Blue Tang are actually transparent. Thankfully, Dory's okay and remembers this film's
P. Sherman 42 Wallaby Way, Sydney.
The Jewel of Morro Bay, California. Dory somehow becomes Sonic and almost goes out into the open ocean at the drop-off. Marlin, remembering what happened last time they were at the drop-off, says it's not happening, but Dory... Not happening this time, but Dory manages to convince him to join her.
All I know is that I miss them.
Crush helps our trio to the California Current, thanks to the California Current, and Marlin ends up feeding the fish. They head to somewhere familiar to Dory's past and end up encountering a giant squid. Beep, boop, beep, boop, beep, boop. Well, I had to reference Squid Game somehow.
And I get the feeling they're shushing us for a reason. You might wake up something dangerous.
Are you talking about, like, something with one big eye, tentacles, and a snappy thing?
Well, that's very specific, but...
Well, that very specific thing happens to be right behind them. Oh, it's not right behind me, is it? No, it's just the Pixar lamp that's behind me. Just missing the Luxor Jr. ball. They manage to escape the squid, and Nemo is clearly traumatized from that. No wonder, given what he went through in the last time. In reality, giant squid prey on deep-sea fish and other types of squid, including other giant squids. Not we fish. Well, you had to establish it as a threat somehow. So scientific inaccuracies can, they can stay for the time being. We also get our first Pizza Planet trunk in sunken form. It's been way too long since I've used that Tamatoa gag during this scene as well. Tension builds between Marlin and Dory, leading to...
You can go wait over there. Go wait over there and forget. It's what you do best.
Bit harsh. Side note. This is why you don't throw plastic away. It goes into the ocean and gets trapped on fish like Dory in this scene. Recycle your plastic, people! Oh, look at me getting preachy about the environment. Anyway. The giant squid in Finding Dory is bioluminescent. In truth, it is unknown if giant squid are even able to create bioluminescence as they do not have photophores, light-producing organs, many bioluminescent creatures have. They do, however, have the ability to change color using chromatophores, as all squid and octopuses do. The giant squid in Vinedory is also a mixture of blacks and blues, likely to make it appear more alien and menacing. In reality, giant squids, while able to change color like octopuses, are actually brick red. The red color helps find them in the dark water as it makes them harder to see, and can turn white. They also shine a bright gold or silver color when light hits them, as evidenced by Tsunemi Kubodera, when he filmed one in 2013. We then hear Sigourney Weaver's voice at the Marine Life Institute. Sigourney was last seen here in the kingdom, also in Wall-E. In Danish, This is where the dubs come into play. In Danish, Sigourney Weaver's voice was replaced by famous health guru Olli Henriksen. Now, Olli is known for appearing on TV shows about skincare, eating proper food and exercising, etc. But has no prior connections with animals and wildlife, though, which makes the replacement choice seem quite random when you put it in this context. In Sweden, the voice of the intercom at the Marine Life Institute is performed by Jonas Wallström. Wallström is a famous Swedish animal expert, owner of the aquarium at the outdoor zoo Skansen. He is also the owner of a sushi restaurant. Ooh, sushi! Might need to make a reservation. In the Spanish dubbed version, in Mexico, the voice of the intercom at Marine Life Institute is performed by Dr. Rodolfo Nerivella, a Mexican scientist and astronaut that has worked with NASA. In Germany, the voice of the intercom at the Marine Life Institute is former world-class swimmer Franziska van Almsick. Italy had famous TV host Licia Colos, who is known for hosting shows about animals and nature, etc.
Where we believe in rescue, rehabilitation, and release.
Dory ends up taken into the Marine Life Institute, and we get introduced to Hank, one of, if not the most difficult character for Pixar to animate, because the animators, Hank only has 7 tentacles, because the animators realized they could not fit 8 onto his body. His backstory was rewritten to account for the missing limb. For similar reasons, in the classic sci-fi film, It Came From Beneath the Sea, special effects genius Ray Harryhausen was only able to create a stop-motion giant octopus with 6 tentacles. Hank is physically based on a Pacific red octopus. Ed O'Neill originally thought that his role as Hank was only a cameo and didn't realize he would be a major character. The photo of Darla from Finding Nemo can be seen in the background during Dory's first visit to the quarantine facility. Hank is an octopus, and therefore he can survive out of water for some time, squirts ink when he's scared, and can change color for camouflage. Hank's behavior is actually very similar to that of a real-life octopus. Octopuses are notoriously hard to keep in captivity, as they are intelligent escape artists. You think we should try and get one to help us in an escape room at some point? They are intelligent escape artists that are known to leave their tanks and wander on land. Curious. His camouflage ability not only has him changing color, but also his shape. A technique used by real life octopuses, especially the mimic octopus, which is what I believe he is, to escape predators or mimic more dangerous animals for defense. On April 1st, of all the dates, Ed O'Neill, the voice actor for Hank, was featured with Andrew Stanton as part of an April Fool's joke, hence the date. The joke involved deceiving viewers into believing that Hank was the oldest and most coveted Pixar Easter egg in history, having been camouflaged as different objects. Oh, that is clever. That is clever. That is brilliant. A similar thing happened with the title character of Wally in 2008. Again, very clever, I would say.
Fish in here, go back in the ocean. Cleveland fish, stay there forever.
Okay, then. No pressure, then. Anyway, Ed was just last seen as the voice of Mr. Litwack in the Wreck-It Ralph movies. Hank wants to take the tag Dory has on her fin so he can go to Cleveland instead. Sounds simple enough. The water pipe seen overhead in the Institute's quarantine room has the same seawater supply TL-59 label as the overhead pipe in the loading zone of the Finding Nemo submarine voyage attraction at Disneyland. Strangely, all of Hank's arms are equally spaced and have surrounding webbing, and he does not seem to have a gap or a stump where his lost arm would have been. Furthermore, octopuses can actually regenerate lost arms, so his inability to regenerate his may imply severe trauma.
Meanwhile, thousands of miles away,
Marlin and Nemo meet Fluke and Rudder, both sea lions, and are voiced by Idris Elba and Dominic West. Dom has been in The Wire, 300, a film adaptation of Chicago, the box office nuclear bomb that is John Carter. Yikes, how much money did that lose at the box office? The voice of the lead elf in Arthur Christmas was a palace guard in The Phantom Menace, a photographer in Spice World. Yes, it's exactly what you think it is. A Spice Girls movie. And Richmond in a film adaptation of Richard III. Idris, meanwhile, was last seen in Zootopia or Zootropolis, depending on your region. And they give us an A113 with their tags. And a hidden Mickey with the holes in the rocks. In the early stages of the sequel, Idris Elba and Dominic West were originally going to portray the villainous Dr. Mobster and the shark hunter Jinx, respectively. But they were scrapped and changed into sea lions instead. The eyebrows on Gerald, the third sea lion, who has no dialogue, resemble those of Baby Gerald, Maggie Simpson's arch enemy from The Simpsons. Many alumni from The Simpsons, most notably Brad Bird, have gone on to work at Pixar.
Sure, that's all right. Don't you worry. Don't you worry about a thing.
The immediate switch from aggression towards Gerald, who's a reference to one of Nigel's friends in the first film, who almost ate Marlin and Dory, to being reassuring towards Marlin and Nemo is comical. The way they shout off to Gerald is an homage to the
mine
seals from Finding from the first film. In Germany, the two sea lions were dubbed with a very heavy, yet still understandable, Bavarian accent. The gag is that even most Germans barely understand it when two or more Bavarians speak in this particular dialect. The only one even more difficult to understand is Low German. The cruel treatment of the sea lions towards Gerald drew controversy and criticism from many audiences, as it appeared that Gerald had an intellectual disability of some sort, and his bullying was played for laughs. Pixar denied this, however, saying that Gerald was a caricature of a playground nerd who is victorious in the end. Fluke and Rubber start calling Becky, who's a bit slow mentally. Dory finds a map for Hank and gives us some marine biology.
No, no, kids! Kids grab things! And I'm not losing another tentacle for you.
You lost a tentacle? Well, then you're not an octopus, you're a septopus.
Dory gets another flashback involving shells, and we get our first major clue as to where her parents actually are. In a tank somewhere in the Institute. Instead, she finds a bucket with Destiny written on it, that turns out to have some fish that are meant for feeding Destiny, and will introduce her very shortly.
Oh, hey, guys, I'm looking for my family. Oh, good idea, play dead.
Slight issue, Dory. They aren't playing dead. They're actually dead. All while Hank tries to catch up and ends up in the door instead. Riley Anderson, a supporting character from Pixar's film Inside Out, has a very brief cameo in this film. Right after Dory is thrown into Destiny's tank, she bumps into the glass viewing window. Riley can be seen in the crowd of children in the back row. The setting of the film was changed from an aquatic park to a marine biology institute after the controversial documentary Blackfish was screened for the crew of Pixar. More on that later. Characters from other Pixar films made cameos as visitors to the Marine Life Institute. These include daycare children from Toy Story 3, some adults and teenagers seen in Inside Out, and some of the dentist's patients, particularly the young boy and mother who had been sitting in the waiting room when Darla arrived from Finding Nemo.
Thank you!
You're welcome!
Destiny manages to somehow reunite Dory as they used to be best friends. Oh, pipe pals. They used to be pipe pals, specifically. In a different version of Finding Dory, where Jenny and Charlie also had short-term memory loss, Destiny was their adoptive daughter, and there would be a sibling rivalry between her and Dory. Destiny reveals that Dory was from the Open Ocean exhibit in the Institute, meaning that must be where her parents are.
Kind of tough for a whale to travel around here.
Can you please keep it down over there? My head hurts.
Hey, I'm trying to make this episode. Ty Burrell voices Bailey, the beluga whale. Ty's been involved in Marvel with The Incredible Hulk in 2008, The Muppets in Muppets Most Wanted, DreamWorks with Mr. Peabody and Sherman and The Penguins of Madagascar, Evolution, Black Hawk Down, National Treasure Book of Secrets, and The Dawn of the Dead remake. Bailey's head can be seen jiggling when he moves or uses echolocation, which he claims doesn't work. While exaggerated, it's shown to emphasize that beluga whales' heads have what's called a melon, which is an organ that looks and feels like a pocket filled with fat used for improved echolocation. Ed O'Neill and Ty Burrell were unaware of each other's presence in the film until much later into production. Destiny might be the reason why Dory can speak whale, even though she's not a true whale, but rather a shark, a whale shark to be exact. Destiny is voiced by Caitlin Olsen, who's been in a lot. She's been in a lot of things, including Coyote Ugly, two episodes, one of them very infamous, A Family Guy, and she was Dee Reynolds in Again, do not let your kids watch it at all. It's very messed up. Most of the animals in this movie have a handicap or disability. Hank has a missing tentacle. Dory has short-term memory loss. Nemo has a small fin. Destiny, the whale shark, has nearsighted blindness. Becky, the loon, is a slight bit slow mentally. And Bailey, the beluga, had a head injury as well. It is believed to be the first Disney or Pixar film to feature a character with a disability, which is false, because it turns out Finding Nemo is technically the first one, because of Nemo's fin and Dory's memory.
Bailey's head is supposed to put out a call, and the echo helps him find objects far away. Oh, but apparently, he's still healing.
Even here, Olsen has an unlikable tone, which is brilliant. Why do I say unlikable? You're not supposed to like the Reynolds in It's Always Sunny. But they're still hilarious all the same. Especially when Danny DeVito came into play from season 2.
Open Ocean? I know where that is. That's the exhibit located right next to... I don't care.
Hank, at least help her find her parents and stop being so miserable.
Caution. Joker at work.
Joke, I got it.
Seek help, Cake? There's always another way.
Back with the sea lions, Becky arrives and Marlin imprints with her and heads to the next stage of the journey, in Gerald's bucket, which is a reference to such an adorable Studio Ghibli film. They allow Gerald on the rock until there's another running gag for the film. Some viewers speculated that the two women in the brief scene of Hank disguising himself as a baby were a lesbian couple. When asked about the unnamed character's sexualities by USA Today, the film's co-director, Andrew Stanton, replied, "They can be whatever you want them to be. There's no right or wrong answer." Dory tries guiding Hank to the open ocean exhibit while the pigeon from Toy Story 3 makes a cameo and Becky leaves Marlin and Nemo in a tree. Dory takes Hank left when she should have gone right. Seen that trope before. One of Riley Anderson's classmates is in the crowd that gathers for the Otter Show as Hank and Dory navigate the park in the stroller. Pink infinity scarf, purple sweater, pigtails, possibly eyeshadow? I don't know. Marlin tries to get Becky's attention only to land in the gift shop fish tank, which Nemo's not impressed with.
Who wants to learn about otters?
We're looking at sea otters.
It's a huge cuddle party. Cuddle party, I'm in.
So much cuteness in this one moment. Hank then snaps.
All right, that's it. You have wasted my time.
Wait, no.
That transport truck leaves at dawn, and I'm not missing it, so wait. Give me your tag.
No.
This then leads to them now being in the kid zone and the touch pool. This won't end well.
Hank?
Hands.
No, not Hans. I'm looking for Hank.
Hands.
Hank with a K. Hank.
Hands.
Zimmer? I'll see myself out.
Hands?
Oh, hands! Ah!
Now, you'd think this was something out of a horror film. Dory gets a flashback apologizing for not remembering properly, giving us the origin of...
Just keep swimming, just keep swimming.
Dory tries to get Hank to keep swimming, only to end up in the Poker's Cove. Why that particular name?
Ah! Stop it!
That's why. Hank inks the kids and causes panic. They find the open ocean exhibit, meaning Dory's so close to finding her parents.
Meanwhile, thousands of miles away.
Nemo criticizes Marlin for belittling Becky, calling back to what happened earlier in the film. Tide pool is the next step, using the fountains to get there. Here, we get a clam voiced by the director, Andrew Stanton. When they ask the clam how he's doing, he enthusiastically responds, "I'm happy." This is a gag relating to the colloquial expression, "happy as a clam."
Oh, Shelley! Why?
Could you be any more on the nose with the pun? Dory's so close to finding her parents. She gives Hank her tag, and they share a solemn farewell. She tries to find her parents without success. She follows the shells, only to find her parents aren't there. She does find a purple shell, though, and discovers, thanks to a couple of hermit crabs, one of them is voiced by John Ratzenberg. Scratch that off my Pixar bingo card. I should really create a Pixar bingo card when I'm watching Pixar films for this. That the blue tangs, which is the first time Dory's fish species is mentioned by name, are heading to Cleveland.
Could you tell me how to get there through the pipes?
Sure, honey. It's two lefts and then a right.
Dory ends up lost in the pipes, but gets help from Destiny and Bailey.
This is amazing!
Did you really have to deliver that in the same cadence as the most overrated Disney film of all time? I'm not apologizing for that! Bailey and Destiny help Dory reunite with Marlin and Nemo. The trio head to quarantine together.
I'm not ready!
Dory is with the rest of the Blue Tangs, only to find they never found her. And she thinks they're gone. The they being her parents, by the way. The visuals do capture the despair she's experiencing, and the music complements this moment beautifully. She finds shells that lead to her parents to give us a very heartwarming reunion. Now, I brought this up in the Finding Nemo episode, that the music here has similarities to parts of the soundtrack from the Ori games.
Hello, I'm...
Dory!
Dory!
I teared up a lot during this scene on my first viewing.
Oh, I haven't been all by myself. Marlin and Nemo!
Final climax time. The truck heading to Cleveland also has an A113. It's Cal A113. CalArts. Dory calls out to death. Calls out to destiny. Sorry, did I just speak well there? Who makes the leap over the wall? Bailey not too far behind. They come up with a plan to stop the traffic, which involves...
We're looking at sea otters.
Thanks, Ewan. The cuddle party works, and Dory is back with Nemo and Marlin.
Uru! Uru! Becky! Becky, come back! We need your help! Becky!
Becky ex machina. She gets Marlin and Nemo back into the ocean, and Dory gives us a great speech that having a plan doesn't always work.
And that's because the best things happen by chance, because that's life, and that's you being with me, out in the ocean, not safe in some stupid glass box.
Can I say something?
I'm not done.
Everyone starts chanting release before the door gets shut. Bailey loses the truck.
Holy carp, there is another way.
Great observation, Dory. Hank stops the truck and starts driving it back the other way, giving us another pizza plan shot in the process. Ah, there's the seagulls from the first film. Bye! The truck's about to get stopped by the cops until...
Ooh, there's no way out! It's over! They're going to fish jail!
Ooh, wait. Ooh, oh no.
Ooh, get back!
Worms airstrike incoming! Sorry. Let me tweak that a little bit. Worms airstrike incoming! All to the sounds of Louis Armstrong. What a wonderful world indeed. Bailey, Hank, and Destiny all become substitute teachers while Mr. Ray is on his migration. Dory heads to the drop-off just to enjoy the view. And it is a great view, much like the Scottish Highlands. All while the theme plays us out. We have one more flashback seeing baby Dory enjoy playing with the kids. We're treated to Sia singing her rendition of the legendary Nat King Cole's Unforgettable over the end credits. Side note, the Luxor Junior Ball, that was the symbol on the steering wheel of the truck. One of the writers for Finding Dory wanted the last shot of the sequel to be the Barracuda from the first film looking hungrily at the reef before the end appears on the screen. It was cut because it didn't make sense for there to be a barracuda at the end of the film. And also, it might have scared the kids after what happened in the last film when a barracuda killed Nemo's mother. So, yeah, probably not a very wise idea to reignite the trauma we had to experience with a barracuda at the beginning of the first film. The ending of the film was rewritten after the creators saw documentary Blackfish, which advocates against the treatment of animals in marine parks. Louis Sy Hoyos, after seeing Blackfish, then they retooled the film so that the sea creatures now have the choice to leave that marine park. They told Gabriella Cow Perthwaite they didn't want to look back on this film in 50 years and have it be their Song of the South. The sleep swimming scene from the teaser trailer was originally part of the movie and was much longer. In the original versions of the movie, all of Dory's flashback sequences were part of one single scene, which would have told all of her backstory at the beginning of the movie. But after a test screening, they decided to tell her backstory through flashbacks over the course of the movie. Originally, Dory's parents would have suffered from the short-term memory loss, which would make Dory's line that her short-term memory loss runs in the family as a fact. But this was changed as Andrew Stanton realized it could be frustrating to have all of Dory's family forget what each other said throughout the movie. There was originally a parents' school day sequence in where Dory was going to start feeling nostalgic for her family, while the Tank Gang do show up in the movie as part of an after-credits scene. They originally had a bigger role. They would have encountered Dory, Nemo, and Marlin after escaping the giant squid, and they would have helped Nemo to rescue Dory from the Institute. Why this didn't end up happening in the final scene, in the final film, hasn't been revealed. But it is believed by fans to be because Stanton is saving the Tank Gang's storyline for the third film, assuming they make one. Hank at one point was going to have an obsession for hot sauce. Bailey at one point was going to be female, and Destiny's sister. And the sisters would have been on bad terms because they, before they reconcile at the end. Another trope we've seen before. Destiny was originally a killer whale instead of a whale shark. Last thing we need is any flashbacks to Free Willy. Why do I say flashbacks to Free Willy? Absolutely heartbreaking. This was most likely changed due to the aforementioned Blackfish influence. Adding to that, Destiny was originally going to be Dory's adopted sister, which I've already mentioned. How that would have worked out is anyone's guess. But the script was rewritten to make them just childhood friends instead. The giant squid was originally had dialogue trying to lure Dory into his clutches by pretending to be her uncle.
Yikes!
In January 2013, while on Ellen's show to promote Struck by Lightning, Chris Colfer was on Squee over the film finally being announced, and practically begged for a part, even if it was just for a one-scene gag, referencing a line from the first film when Dory mumbles, "Sea Monkey has my money," in her sleep. Colfer pitched a scenario where Dory encounters said sea monkey. There's a special dedication again to the orchestra for bringing the music to life, which has sort of become signature at this point. I mean, how can you go wrong with a Pixar soundtrack? A special dedication at the end of the credits to all the families of every kind for keeping us swimming. We get a post-credit scene as well with the Tank Gang, and of course,
Jacques
keeps his bag clean.
Now what?
Rescue, rehabilitation, and release. That's what's next. Gerald snickers to himself as he's on the rock with Fluke and Rudder, completely oblivious as they sleep. Oh man, that was fun, sir. That was fun to relive that little gem. Now, on to the scores. The story gets an 8. There are a few plot points from the first film being used here, and that does keep the score from going higher due to this. But despite that, though, some of those tropes do have a fresh spin on them, so I admire them for doing that. The characters, I give a 9. The characters we know from the first film are fun to be around, and the new characters do get their time to shine, especially characters like Becky. The visuals, you knew I was going to give them an 11. The visuals were already beautiful in the first film, and this film polishes them up to make them even more beautiful. How that's possible is beyond me. Advancements in technology, I'm going to put it down to that. The soundtrack, that gets another 11. Another beautiful, faultless soundtrack from Newman, giving us hints of the first film while providing some fresh beauty to listen to. And now, the legacy. So, here we go. Released with a short called Piper, whose title character cameos in the film. $1.029 billion at the box office on a budget of $200 million. 94% on Rotten Tomatoes, with consensus stating, funny, poignant, and thought-provoking, Finding Dory delivers a beautifully animated adventure that adds another entertaining chapter to its predecessor's classic story. The film won 2 Teen Choice Awards and 3 Kids' Choice Awards for Nickelodeon. Winning for Favorite Film, hashtag Squad Up, and Favorite Voice in an Animated Movie at the Kids' Awards, and winning Choice Summer Movie and Choice Female Summer Movie Star at the Teen Awards. Both of the Voice and Movie Star Awards were, of course, for Ellen DeGeneres. I mean, was there ever any doubt? 3 Annie nominations and a BAFTA nomination for Best Animated Film. A Saturn Award win for the film as well. But no Oscar nominations this time around. I think this is a good sequel, but I'll likely stick to the first film more, personally. Not for nostalgia's sake, but for the fact that it's the more memorable film. That being said, I still recommend watching this. 93% is the final score. It's still a solid score, in my eyes, despite just missing out on the top 10. So there we go. That is it for this episode of The Kingdom of Isolation, looking at Finding Dory. If you enjoyed this episode, hit the thumbs up. And if you want to be part of The Kingdom of Isolation yourself, you can hit the subscribe button down at the bottom, click the bell, turn on notifications so you don't miss when an episode goes live on this channel. The next episode, we're heading back to the track. It's Cars 3, where I decide when I'm done. But until then, I'll see you guys next time in The Kingdom of Isolation.